So let's just, I think we got some other people. We got Raven as well. So we got a mix of people that play on the GLAN server. I wouldn't say that we're all... Raven, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
All right. And we might get a few more people that pop in during this recording. So basically what we're going to touch base on today is the producer's letter that just came out maybe about... maybe about 48 minutes ago. So we just want to just go through it and get everybody's thoughts on what they feel this letter means and, you know, whether or not it's a good thing, a bad thing, or is it just sort of a, you know, a shielding or a redirect of where the game should be going.
That's
in terms
a bad
of
thing.
Functions and features. Yeah. So one of the first topics out of here is that touched base on it is the... you know, the new raids, the Haunted Hall, and the guild changes that came about. So I'll start at that. I'll start that off. I have to say, I really do like the three new raids. I think they're good raids for a lot of good reasons. Maybe the Fire on Thunder Peaks is a little short. It could have been a little bit better in terms of length.
Like, I think real strength with those raids is just they require teamwork, and that's an awesome part of the game, and it really keeps people playing, and it's a good thing. Sorry. If you want to continue, Vass.
Yeah, just, I agree. I think you have to have teamwork with these three, you know, three raids. I know that there are some people that can short man it and whatnot, but generally speaking, I think the Deathworm is a really good raid. I'm actually a big fan of that one, and I really do like the fact that the Slayer area is the flagging as well. It's a little different than how we did raids in the past, where you had to do multiple quests to actually get flagged for the raid. So it's a new take on how you flag for a raid. In that sense,
I'm going to disagree with Deathworm being a good raid. I think the first half is overly tedious and high in gimmicks. I don't really like the puzzles delaying the start of the actual raid. It seems disjointed. I'm in favor of more thought-provoking quests, but not necessarily in a raid environment where people want to get it over and done with as quickly as possible. The Shroud is interesting. Exception to that, because each of the different stages is interesting to a point, but not overbearing and long. So yeah, I don't think the Deathworm is a great raid, but
the strength of the puzzle in Shroud is just that you're gonna die if you don't learn how to do the puzzle. So there's some urgency because that, you know. I felt like the mirrors, well, I think there's just too many mirrors, there's no urgency.
Right, there's no urgency. It's just overly tedious, really. And one or two people do the mirrors while everyone else just AFKs or kill skeletons.
Yeah, I have to agree. I mean, I like Shroud. I like how the puzzles are short. You're not really hit with a lot of puzzles. Like, you know, in Shroud, you got a DPS part that you have to do in some waves. The second part, you have a sort of a DPS part, but it's sort of like, you know, let's get them all together and then kill them at once. And then the third part is some little puzzles, you know, the little lights on puzzles. And then the fourth part and the fifth part are all, you know, fourth part is more of a time, you know, a time DPS. And then the last part is, you know, let's just finish it up. It's all everybody all in, right? I don't feel like that's the same in Deathworm. I mean, Deathworm, I think the puzzle thing is, the mirror things is a little, you know, is a little annoying. Not really,
right?
Not really fun, right? In the sense that...
Yeah, definitely.
You have to do how many of those? Three?
I think it would be fun, more casual environment in a quest group, in a six-person party. But when you're in a raid, it's just, it's kind of a speed bump. Is something you don't really enjoy, but you'll do it because you have to get to the second part of the raid.
Right. I think that like, would be solved by a sense of urgency. But anyway, I think let's move on from that. I'll just talk about the lag a little bit that we've all been experiencing. I mean, because yeah, we're gonna go over the beginning of the letter and just touch on that.
There is no lag.
Yeah, that's the joke.
As I die here, awaiting my death for 5 minutes, doing nothing.
The lag in our three endgame raids now, Mark of Death, Deathworm, and Fire Peaks. I know a lot of people experience lag in those raids, and it's really tough on the player base when the new content doesn't work well. So I really encourage everyone there, the developers, to look at that. It's just stupid.
Well, it's not so much new content anymore. This is old content. These three raids are old content now.
Right, so, and that's part of the problem too. Is I don't know. I don't feel like
they're getting like looked at.
I guess one of my ideas was, you know, do we need to have groups of people run those raids on Lamania and work out the kinks with a developer? Like, because I'm totally open to that idea. I don't know how do you guys feel about that?
Well, I think you know, you're going to have latency and lag in any MMO. I think that's just sort of a given. I think if it's, you know, if it's once or twice, if it's, you know, a full stop lag, I see that, you know, how are we really going to identify that? I mean, is Turbine going to ever really tell us what the cause of that? And I'm sure from, you know, anyone that's from a technical background, it could be multitudes of things, you know. Is it their hardware? Is it the mechanic of the game itself? Is it the AI? Or is it, you know, is it something on our end, right? I don't think it's something on our end, because generally when the lag does hit, it really affects everyone. And the weird thing is I've seen this from time to time, is that even though the lag hits you in a particular map, it may affect people outside of that instance as well. Like in, you know, you do Deathworm, and then next thing you know, Evening Star's locked up. So I'm not really sure, you know, how that spreads out. But if they could give us some guidance on that instead of just being quiet, you know, like, you know, one of the workarounds we found in Deathworm is that if everybody logged out except for like two people and you were stuck, generally it would free itself up and then people would just log back in, you know, incrementally. And then you would fight a little bit more, the lag would show up again, and you would disconnect. And you would sort of leapfrog that, rinse and repeat, until you got through Deathworm. And
see, but that right there is ridiculous. And it's absolutely ridiculous, right, that this is happening. Like, I'm sorry, but like, what games out there right now are experiencing lag like this, where it's taking an hour raid and making it into, you know, an hour and a half raid, because everyone is, you know, playing with the lag mechanic? But
I agree. Let's not spend too much time on it, but I do think that lag needs to be looked at. Either make the latency indicator on your bar a little bit more intelligent to let us know when lag is going to hit, or tell us what's causing the problems. You know, even as a workaround, like we all know that what's the Divine Crusader or of Purification?
Right.
You know,
right.
We all know that does cause lag. You know, if you got three or four people with that on in EE Mark of Death, you will notice that for the most part, you're going to lag up everything when mobs start spawning. You turn it off, the lag goes away. So we know some parts of the mechanics exist, but it would be really nice to say, you know, either tell us some workarounds, even if you're admitting that there are problems there, or fix it. You know,
I think,
like, ask for help too. I mean, I know there are lots of players who would love to log on to Lamania and sit down with the developer and just go through the raids. Like, they'd be happy to do that.
Oh yeah, there's many people. I know I would. I know we would. The fan base of DDO would definitely want to contribute, you know, as a user test group to the developers if needed. You know, to provide a UAT, that's user acceptance testing for those who are not in the software industry, you know, to help better the game.
God, Vass. You're so condescending, Vass.
Personally
so
speaking,
let's move on to
I think Elias should be made a priority, because if you're taking the three endgame raids, the only endgame a player of DDO has, and you're making them unplayable or increasingly frustrating and aggravating to play, those people aren't going to want to log in. And if you don't have, and with the player base the way it is, increasingly smaller and smaller with each month, you really need to keep the players that you do have. It's so it should be a priority in my book.
Right, I agree. So let's. I think we've covered a good part of the lag. I feel as if we may need to make a separate roundtable just on the lag itself. But let's move on a little bit. What about the changes to guilds and airships? The new
awesome.
Guilds and airship functionality.
Changes, all of them. I think the devs did an awesome job. Very cool.
Yeah, I have to agree. I was actually pretty ecstatic when the changes came out. I am a little hesitant on the color schemings that they use for these guild colors. I think the red was probably a really bad choice at the very end. But
well, that's
I think
whole mark
giving
of
colors
shame thing, you know, because
yeah,
I'm not gonna say that people were exploiting, but you know. That guy in Necro got talked to a lot.
Oh, it's possible with Saugus to get your renown up there, but it's, you know, how many people did actually do that?
Not in a week, man. Not in a week.
Right.
Which comes back to actually the fixes that happened in last year with the duping. That's good. Several.
Oh, yeah, that was
fixed,
always great.
And we all saw that and appreciated it, guys. Thank you. We appreciate that.
Yeah, that was a big good thing. What about Mirror of Glamoring? I know some people don't like it. What's not to like, right?
It's great. I think it's a little bit expensive right now, but that's okay. The price will probably come down over time. But,
it's,
you know,
very
it's cosmetics.
Expensive.
So
when you have to make... you first have to use a Mirror of Glamoring to make a cosmetic item. And then if you wish to make a weapon aura, you can't use the weapon aura on the base item. You have to have that cosmetic first. So to add an aura to a new item, it's around maybe $4. It's a little bit expensive.
Oh, I thought it was a little bit.
Yeah,
more
I would
than
say
that. That's not bad. That's not bad.
I would I say it's I probably highly it. Expensive. I know I've spent and Tess, I know I've you were there the day I bought maybe about $50 worth of cosmetics. Going through all
and
my weapons and stuff. Zilda, I think you were there
the
as well.
And you got to spend money on a game for it to keep
The
going.
Problem is
That's...
compounded, however, because there's no preview. So you buy one aura, it looks okay, but it's not what you were expecting. So
you're
paying to
preview is basically
right,
what you're
exactly.
doing. Which I did not like. I did anyway. You know, and I'm not going to fault them on that. It is fluff. You know, it's something to appease, you know, the people who like the visual look and to you know, all the other bases that are into that. But the paid preview was is not a good thing. I think that's bad marketing there. The second bit I had was I really was under the assumption, you know, the assumption that I was going to be able to run a cosmetic aura itself on any weapon and not just apply a cosmetic aura to a cosmetic weapon. So I was a little let down on that. I don't mind running the cosmetics. I think some of them look really good. I actually used to, know what weapon I had, not just by my bar, but basically looking at my tune all the time. And, I would have preferred to have been able to apply, you know, a single aura to all the different types of weapons I had, instead of having to cosmetic a weapon and then apply ore to that cosmetic.
Yeah.
I think a return to the old mechanics where you apply the cosmetic to each piece of each item would be necessary in this case. Because I don't know how many times I've been running around with Epic Island's Edge on a Bard, which is a buff instrument instead of my Thunderforged endgame weapon. Because I have a cosmetic on, I don't know the difference visually until I look at my damage numbers and I'm like, oh, so that's why I'm taking twice as long or three times as long to kill something.
Right, yeah, I definitely agree. I think it has its place, but it's just one of those things. Good. A little bit of fluff.
You know, if you look at a game like Path of Exile, and they're, like, completely funded by, like, cosmetic stuff, almost, which is really silly and kind of funny. I don't know.
Right, but at the same time, MMOs are like that. They don't charge anything for anything else besides cosmetics.
Right, right. And their cosmetics are very expensive. Very expensive.
Yeah, relatively.
I think a pair of like their cosmetics are a little bit more complicated or something. It was crazy. But
yeah, their cosmetics are a little bit more complicated too, because you can apply it to your weapons, to your
abilities.
You know, your minions, your ability. I mean, you can apply cosmetics to a lot of stuff, not just a helmet and armor and your weapon. So you got a lot going on there.
And all right, no fee for unsocketing a gem or an augment in this case.
Yeah, that's true. There's no dollar value associated with that. But then again, I do get occasional. I do get the friggin' jeweler's toolkit every now and then in a daily roll or as an M reward on something. Oh, then I've seen lucky. Them in chess.
You're awfully lucky. Yeah.
You know, they're in the DDO store. They're in the auction house, you know, under 100,000 plat. So they're not rare, that rare to be obtained.
No, but it's the principle of the matter. You should not have, you know, it's a mechanic in the game. Augments now, they're here to stay. You shouldn't be getting charged to remove an augment and place it on another item. It's just out and out pay to win.
I completely agree. In the old days, and you know, that's what the whole point of those Sibri shards, you know, the yellow and the purple shards, and epic tokens, you could unslot your augment with an epic, you know, with tokens. It didn't cost you any DDO points, or you could reslot it with another slot.
Or you could they used to have this mechanic built into the game where if you didn't want to buy stuff from the store, you could grind for a week or 2 weeks or a month and gradually get to where you wanted to be without the outlay of money. But now more and more, it's store specific and store exclusive.
Yeah. I don't want to play devil's advocate, but it's kind of the same way. Now the DDO store, you know, that particular functionality lets you keep your augment. Now you could, in essence, replace that with other augments or possibly clear it. I think you can still clear all your augments with the epic tokens, but you lose your augment in the end.
You know what I would like though is some way in game to get lesser hearts of wood, +1, maybe +3, so we could get rid of the first life on an iconic class without having to pay $10 worth of points on the store. I mean, yes, you can get those hearts of woods rarely in game, but they're too rare to count on. So I'd like a way to build towards getting one of those, like you can with the TR woods, the iconic hearts of wood.
All right, let's try to stay a little bit on topic, but I think we can grab that one in another round.
Yeah, that's the money topic. We can touch that later.
Yeah, so let's move on to champions, to the monster champions.
Great idea, great difficulty at first, incredibly bad implementation. When I first heard about champions,
when I
first heard about champions, I envisioned mobs in little nooks and crannies of the quest you don't normally visit, but you can go there for a new mob that drops a specific item. But instead, we got, you know, 10% or 15% of all enemies. Or even not enemies, you know, you get statues that are champions for some reason. You get across the board generic champions with generic loot. great idea to spice up the game's difficulty. Terrible implementation. That's my take.
I agree. The implementation could have been a little better, I think.
A little better.
I mean, I agree that that certain mobs need to be immune to it, but somewhere in the coding, it must have just applied to everything. And I guess that's something probably we should stay away from in the game is just making large changes like that, because you can do things to character or to the monsters that you wouldn't intend. It was heavy-handed, I guess.
See, but the part of the problem is that the game has gone on a progression towards zerging, which is, well and good for people who like zerging, and that's what the game has become. But once you throw in unpredictable modifiers to randomly generated champions, it kind of put this corkscrew in that.
When a zerger dies. When someone's zerging and then they just get one-shotted, it's flipping hilarious, man. I remember walking into EE Tor solo and just playing, and then this champion giant runs up, and I didn't know it, but he had fort bypass and extra damage, and he crit me for like 2k, and I just died. And that's a dwarf barbarian with 1700 health. Like, that's a lot of health. Like, he did a lot of damage,
I really like that though.
The game is set up for zerging for most purposes. If you're going to implement a champion that kind of slows down that aspect of the game, at least make it more easier and more noticeable to I'm not talking about the crown, because the crown just says it's a champion, period. First of all, if there's a pack of a dozen or two dozen monsters, it's a pain in the neck to target that damn thing. Second of all,
I disagree with that, but okay.
Targeting?
Sorry, go on.
It's a real pain.
You just right-click him.
In the middle of a
pack. Cycle
anyway, that's not the point. You're going to make it a point.
That's a strategy. Let's not differ from the thing. So I agree with Zild. I think the implementation, two implementations here.
Let me finish real quick. It should be easier to target, and secondly, it should be easier to see what the heck they have at a glance, like a Fury Aura for extra damage, or emanating a Dark Aura for, I don't know, Fort Bypass, I don't know. But it should be easier to tell if it's going to kill you outright or if you have some leeway. Go ahead.
Right. That's a
I agree, but I think that gets into the functionality of how do we see buffs and debuffs on mobs quickly or in a more simplistic fashion. Right now we have to target and cycle through and bring up their panel and then
because the game is locked their panel and then, right now, so you have to think in terms of that fast paced environment.
Right. So bringing up that panel and doing all that stuff, it's kind of, by the time you're there, someone's already killed it or something's happened.
Or you've already died.
I think that's something they should look into.
With a UI overhaul. I mean, DDO could use a UI overhaul. It really could.
Not the skinning UI thing that they did. Yeah, not the one that they already had, which is nice. But it didn't really do, it didn't really change a lot. I don't think it changed any of the windows. So the only thing that really changed was the XP bar, which was a nice increase. But let's stay on topic. So, champions. I think great idea. The first wave, maybe they were a little too powerful for too many of them for the thing. I actually didn't mind it. I liked it. I wish it would have stayed that way. I never had a problem with targeting a mob or if I did die, blaming that functionality. I think it slows you down. you need to think about what you're doing when you're around these guys. Some people don't like that.
When you're playing crowd control and you have to target that mob quickly or else it's going to kill somebody or kill yourself, and the mob is moving around in the pack, in a larger pack, I think it does become an issue, at least for me.
I think that's fun, man. Because landing a stun. I think that's normal.
You know, when you're fighting a boss or something in real life, they're always throwing the nubs out in front. You know, to take the hits before you take the big boss. So I think that I like that. It's got a appeases me.
Right. So Monster Champions.
Let's move on.
Thank you.
Monster Champions, good idea. Maybe needs to be revisited a little bit. Maybe break out the difficulty between Epic, Elite, and everything else a little bit more. But overall, good stuff. Let's move on to...
One buff they don't have.
Go ahead.
Immunity to crowd control. Make that a rare buff, but I want it in there.
Yeah, basically give them FOM so they can't get webbed or held. Or something like that.
Yeah, give them, that would be easy. That would be an easy good buff.
Yep.
And like, you know, so just let's move on to the FOM symbol permanent above its head. I'm sorry.
I mean, that's okay. We're getting into UI development, right? So I'm sure that there's some different ways that they could tackle that, but I think it needs to be revisited. So let's move on to Player Council. Player Council. Anybody? Me personally, I don't think they've done shit.
No, they did a good job. I know a couple guys on there, and you know, I think it helps humanize the whole relationship between the community and the developers, and it gives both of them an avenue to do stuff. However, I think that some of the stuff with the Players Council should be made public, so that everyone can see what's going on. Rather than making it private. I know that some things should be private, but I know that, like, some of the discussions, maybe make those public, just so in retrospect, but I don't know.
I think the topics should be transparent and the discussions private, right? So, I'd like to know what the Player Council is really speaking on behalf of the fan base for. Right. If they're wondering whether or not we should have a new currency, I think we don't need a new currency. So that should not be something, you know, we should even debate. Right. It doesn't need to be there. But if it has to be there, then, you know, then at least we have some transparency. We know how the player base knows what they're, you know, what we're to expect. And we can get the backlash out sooner than after it's already been developed and being tested in Lamania.
Well, Kickstarter, completely detour of a topic, but Kickstarter was nice because it put the development out front amidst the fans. If a project was funded by the fans, then the fans generally had mostly full access to what's going on behind the scenes, to what features getting developed. And if there's something completely haywire in the developers' minds about what the fans want, the fans are going to tell them outright, oh, we don't want that. We want this. And in a lot of situations, that can actually lead to a better game, more interesting dynamics, mechanics. So more transparency is better in the long run. It's certainly more overhead in the short term, but it's better in the long run.
What if Turbine put its Let me get this out real quick. What if Warner Brothers and Turbine put out their proposed changes on Kickstarter?
I was going to say the exact same thing. That's just an awesome idea.
And we could actually,
right?
You know, maybe, like, the fan base would pay for it. It's not like we haven't paid for it before.
Kickstarter is good at funding 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 million for game development. It's never going to get the funding.
You don't need that much. Like, that's a good way, let's put up three different packs that we could potentially do, or, like, a lag fix. Like, I'd be down for doing a Kickstarter for a lag fix.
I would not, because that's basic game functionality. I should not have to pay for basic game functionality.
I agree.
I shouldn't have to pay for not dying in a game I'm already paying for.
Yeah. Yeah, mechanics, I don't want a Kickstarter for mechanics. That's core foundation stuff, and that should just that goes into just sustaining, maintaining a product, right? But if they came out and said, look, you know, we think about
it, really does.
I agree, and I think Kickstarter is a place to go, you know. It's not like we haven't paid for stuff before, through these little these little things that come up every now and then, you know, and you get the donations, these little drives we've all donated and whatnot, and you know, we get some a nice weapon added to the game, or you know, something like that. Maybe cosmetics can do damage, right? Or cosmetics throw a random buff. Who wants to, you know, pay for the Kickstarter of that? That's more than they would ever get probably from the DDO store. So and it shows a commitment from the from the fan base. And I don't think there's many MMOs that are doing it. So so there's that for that. Now let's move on to the next bit.
Some other time, because I think that's a great topic.
Yeah, and another roundtable. I completely agree. So the big happy part of this is the Temple of Elemental Evil.
I don't know, man. The place ecstatic. Is pretty evil.
I know. I am completely ecstatic that this is going to be made into a playable quest. I think there is a huge room to do wrong, but if they follow the Haunted Halls, I think it's going to be so good. That
please get just, another old guy narrator. Just get like old Dungeons and Dragons player to come in.
Just go to the local hospice.
Just with a gruffly voice and just have him say everything, because it just makes it awesome, man. It's
yeah.
Well, Gary Gygax is an old guy, so not everything can be perfect.
Yeah, well, he's dead.
Well, yeah. Rest in peace, Gary, but you did not narrate that well.
10 years?
God, Gary, jeez. All right.
Jeez. So, yeah, any old whiskey drinker will do. So, I'm a little sad that they're not going to do the prequel quest, so we're not going to get the Fort Town. I'm a little sad at that. You know, I think that would have been easy to do, even if it was scrubby. You know, just to appease the people. There you go, Kickstarter. I'd pay for it too, man. I'd throw $100 in there.
Like I said, the problem with kickstarting is that MMO development is really costly, and kickstarting is not really good at developing those amounts of funds.
I don't want to hear that, man. You're throwing up problems. I want solutions.
All right.
Don't be a wall, be a bridge.
Monster champions and mysterious fragments. These mysterious fragments, what are they going to do?
We talked about the monster champions, and we're back here again, and it's like...
No, let's just
I like the chess. I like the chess that they drop, but it's kind of like...
I love
once you've seen, five chests floating in the air, it gets old.
20 chests. It's hilarious.
It's good for guild renown and not much else.
No, it's good for tomes, man. Anyway, so
let's not dive into that. So yeah, we're gonna get some new loot out of that, and that's gonna be good. That will make that there. I guess that's there to hope, appease the people that see the champions as more of a block in the game, with no real benefit. And they just don't understand how quest progressions work. But I think that's kind of good. I prefer there be more champions in a quest.
My one hope for Mysterious Fragments is that they don't abandon that system right after the update, like they do.
They will.
Flesh it out.
It'll
more
be like
with,
whatchamacallit.
Upcoming updates.
It'll be like the seeds. You double click a seed, you can get a pot. You can get two or three different types of pot. And some hearts, and that's it. So you'll double click a mysterious fragment and get some shit you never use.
You get a +1 heart. Come on, let's make that drive.
Oh yeah, now that's a good idea. Now that I could get behind that. That or just add that to the seeds.
Guys, I want a prestigious and rare pet. I will repeat.
Yes.
I want a prestigious and rare pet.
You mean a rare pet that anyone else will have when they kill a few champions?
No, not just that.
That prestigious.
Exactly, it's prestigious.
Yes. It should definitely make you look different, better than everyone.
Like,
all right, let's move on.
I want ability.
I want a half-wing pet.
I want to move on.
It's a pet, and I want to name it Sestra. and make it a halfling pet. Because it's a monkcher. It's going to be a little monkcher halfling pet. Anyway.
I want an aura that turns me into a tile. And I want to fight in two dimensions for all time.
Yes.
By the way, I just with some of the stuff in that quest. That was really cool.
We will get to that part. All right. Warlocks. Really? Warlocks? Out of all the
It's awesome.
You're going to pick a warlock.
Yep. I'm actually looking forward to another arcane.
Casters are already the single most OP class in the game. And now you're going to add another class? Really?
Fui, Vasax. Fui. That's absolutely false.
I would have preferred...
I think we summed up right there exactly how we all feel about new classes.
As Swashbuckler and Paladin overhauls have indicated, Turbine is moving towards that, you know, ever-increasing casual power curve.
Power!
So I think Warlocks are going to be the next great thing. And
you know what I want to point out, man, is that you omitted Barbarians from that. Now, I'm going to take just put in my shtick. Barbarians are the most powerful melee right now. They are. If you look at the beatdown time for breaking the ranks, a Barbarian just beat Cetus by 1:07.
Well,
And he was on a dwarf. He was on a little thing.
Do you want to say that's true DPS of the build or because of Mortal Fear? I'm going to say because of Mortal Fear.
No. Barbarians, they just keep cleaving. And man,
Amazing.
Barbarians are so one-dimensional you should have some return on that investment.
Cetus has got a Mortal Fear versus no Mortal Fear, breaking the ranks. And you can see the difference. It is big, but
yeah, it's minutes.
Let's talk
difference.
About Mortal Fear later. I don't want to complain
about
that.
Okay. So back to Warlocks. No, don't do it. Give me the Kobold race before.
No, we need both. I need a Kobold Warlock. Anyway,
give me gnomes before Kobolds. Jeez.
Can we link the soundboard for the kobolds in here? Because I feel like that's an important part of DDO. It's just that soundboard.
Yeah, I should link that in. I mean, look at this. Warlocks are Eldritch-based, right? We already have the Eldritch Knight.
Which is a
complete fail. Sorry. Okay. It's at the very bottom. Boy. You know, it's good mediation DPS. It's a fun little change. But don't bring in Warlock and if you're going to, what are you going to do?
Vasax, I'm just ignoring everything you're saying right now. Just ignoring
it. Yeah. Kobolds. All I'm saying.
All right,
let's move on. So, I am a huge fan of the Zoriat packs and the whole theme Zoriat stuff, you know, the Harbinger series and all that was great stuff, and the new three quests that they came out, I could see no wrong with Terminal Delirium. Just fantastic quest, right?
The loot.
What I can't see is the loot was shite. It had nothing to do with the quest.
Amazing for a necro cleric.
The loot should be more Zoriat in nature.
It's like somebody from Walmart came in and designed their gear.
The best item out of there is only for a necro cleric. You should take a step back, because that's pretty niche. Like, that's so niche that, yeah.
Anyway. There's healers in this game now?
There's a necro healer for, anyway. Let's talk about Shavrath.
So, yeah, the new stuff. So, we already know that that D&D itself, you know, the Wizards of the Coast, has burned out the Tyranny of Dragons. We know that Neverwinter MMO is going to get that, but it looks like DDO won't get that. So, is this an interim thing? I mean, I'm not really. I'm irritated because this is another story arc that's going to fail. That's being shelved out of the
Shavrath was one of the Temple best of Death environments they ever developed, and it was abandoned after one quest line. I like their return. I like the return to that.
I am not debating that. I agree with you. I think the Shaver, I think a new Devil story arc is probably one of the most long anticipated things. I know, you know, Epic Veil will be one of the most long anticipated things. But here's the thing. You can't do it halfway like you did Necro. Can't do Necro and not, you know, you gave us Necro, which was great, and but you didn't give us Litany. And that's what, you know, for me, that's what everybody really wanted, was Litany and Abbott. And so what are we going to really get out of Shadowrath and Twilight? Shadowrath, are we going to get a new pack, but actual, you know, the first Devil storyline, is that going to get, you know, epic? You know, are we going to get that? Because we didn't see that with, you know, with the Zoriat pack. The third one came out, it was epic, but the two with the Harbinger 1 and 2 didn't get epic. So, you know, how's that going to play out? And then we have the Veil. You know, I hope everything that's related to the Veil goes epic, including Shroud. I don't know if we'll get Greensteel epic, but, you know, we can always hope.
You know, I don't care how they do it. I just hope the drop rates are low and everything is tradable. Because for some of the older players, it really keeps them in the game if they can farm nice items and sell them to new players, you know, for shards or whatever. And, you know, I feel like some of the new packs, the drop rates are even a little high, and they don't encourage farming by people with time, you know, and who, you know, they've mastered the game. Like, I know Zilt has been running the Insightful Optics out of Tor for, like, a month now. 2 months, man? How long have you been doing that?
Well, just a month off and on.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't even need them. It's just for other people.
Right. I see, but that's something to do, and it's a nice activity. You know, you have your dailies that you run when you're at endgame. And
oh, don't introduce that term. Oh God, I hope they don't implement dailies.
But that's what it turns into, right? Like, you want to farm this gear. I mean, that's why I run Haunted Halls. But I mean, they increase the drop rates. I don't know. It's, but you know, I don't know. I'm just putting that out there. But
I would like to. I agree. You know, I don't know about you, but, you know, I pretty much got everything out of... I got everything and everything upgraded within 1 month of Epic Necro coming out.
Well, Epic Necro was crazy. It gave us raid loot from repeatable party quests. And you could even get named loot from the quest arc reward from the NPC. It's just too easy overall to get stuff from there. And the items are too good for the effort involved.
Yeah, I mean, right. It really did introduce a new point. Level of power creep.
Right, you got to balance effort with power. Like, I mean, the drops on the mythic helms and how those are set up are good. Right now, it's appropriate, I feel. I also feel like the drops in Three Barrel Cove are now where they should be. I feel like I farmed a Jack Jibber's Blade out recently, and it took me a while, but you know, that's good. I ran it every day, and that was just something that I did.
Oh, you didn't even pull it, though.
No, I didn't. Someone else pulled it for me, but you know, and that's part of the game, too, is, you know, you're trying to gear up your friends, and you know, you have these activities that you do. Like, why do we play DDO, especially at the end game?
Sadism?
Yeah, I agree. Sadism.
Masochism?
Satanism?
No, Satanism.
A little masochism. Hey, never hurt anybody. So, yeah, I agree. I mean, with the they just redid the drop rate increase, and stuff has been dropping a little bit more, and I think, now that I think back, maybe that wasn't a good idea.
Alright, so I think this is getting a little long. Can we each just, like, sum up what we think about level 30 and the new festivals with a couple of sentences?
Level 30, please don't go above level 30. I'm fine with level 30 being it. I don't see a need to ever go beyond 30. We don't need anything beyond 30. Stop it.
Yeah, I agree. Don't screw up level 30. Just wait if you need to. Wait as long as you need to release that so that the game has some staying power for a couple more years.
I disagree. I disagree. If they're putting off level, if they're putting off the end game until level 30, I want level 30 now because there is no end game practically. So please, end game, man, please, like now, please, because I'm bored out of my mind.
Two more levels. I mean, that's going to be, what is that? That well, you're going to get two more feats and one more stat point. I mean, that's going to be. I mean, really, can the power creep get any more radical?
Yeah, I don't know if the new raids need to be easier than they are right now. I feel like the difficulties are.
I don't think the power creep has happened from feats or stat points. I think it's happened from the enhancement overhaul, and the game difficulty hasn't compensated for that. So it's just gotten crazy casual, crazy easy, ever since the enhancement overhaul took place.
Right.
All right. Well,
yeah, I think it's all accumulative.
Level 30. New festivals.
Yep.
I hope the mimic. I don't care A-bar? About the mimics.
I mean,
I don't care about the mimics.
Let's talk about that. I care about
the
mimics.
My bad.
So I definitely care about the mimics. I think that's the game needs more.
More mimics?
I don't like the fact. Yeah, the game needs more mimics. I think I would have preferred that mimics themselves have been an overall global mechanic based on the type of chests. You know, like you have the smaller chests, you have the medium chests, you have the, you know, each there's like five or six different types of actual chests, and they could have been maybe a percentage about it, like 5% chance that a little nubby chest could have spawned a mimic at the level of the quest that you're in. I think that would have been a fun little surprise that would have just been something to enhance the game throughout. Not something that was really there to kill you, just
at the end of a quest,
enhance the fun of the quest.
You're typically running dry on spell points, or you're low health, and you expect to be done with a quest. And for an enemy to simply pop out of nowhere unexpectedly and kill you when you have two health left. I think that'd be
I'm sorry.
Unfair.
I mean, that's
I'm
the
sorry.
Risk
I
of
think I just
the
changed
chests.
My opinion. I'm absolutely in favor of making every chest a chest. And please make
that bug
where you can like open the chest multiple times and
yes.
spawn multiple mimics.
Oh yes.
Definitely a
yes.
good bug.
But
lovely.
Right. I mean at
how to irritate
at lower levels
you
I don't think
left.
They would be that 101. Bad. I think it's a risk, right? We need to introduce more risk. More risk gets you thinking, and that
risk.
Gets you more involved
in
the game.
I like tactical risk. I like planning for the risk. I don't like risk out of nowhere. That's why I don't really like champions.
What do you mean? That's randomality, man. That's life. You just can't control everything.
I think, let's say goodbye or whatever. I'm done here.
All right. Okay. So I do want to wrap up Maybar. We didn't get a Maybar this year. That kind of irritated me.
I was really okay about that.
I like Maybar, but Maybar after you, if and when, hopefully when you get the lag fixed.
Yeah, Maybar was quite awful.
I think that's a good ending note. That's good.
Yeah, I have nothing else to go on that, so we'll go ahead and wrap it up, and we'll see you next roundtable.